Yes, my name is Santhosh Daniel, and I am moderator of this panel, Ditching the Divide. And essentially what this is we're going to give you an introduction to people who are working in an alternate dimension of... not really. A different dimension of new media and technology, or what we sometimes generally refer to as transmedia. For the purposes of everything from social activism to personal expression to artistic expression, collaboration, collaborative works with technology, and to the point of also being in the nonprofit sector, which a lot of people up here represent that in some way, shape, or form, and then also public broadcast. The five people that you see here are pretty much in my spectrum, in my sort of field of reference, represent some of the best of what I see in terms of new media and where it's going in the future. And what we're going to try to do over the next hour is we're going to get them to talk about their work and what they're doing and take some questions from the audience at the same time. And hopefully over that time, we'll be able to see actually where you see the future of media and technology and ultimately cinema and how it all pieces together. So before we introduce them, I just want to also quickly mention at the end of the panel, we'll take a very, very short break. And then after that, we will be showing a short film presented by Matthew Meschery of ITVS that is one filmmaker's version or vision of what the future might look like involving digital technology and media. So without further delay, I'm going to have each person introduce themselves, and then we'll start over here with Tanya to talk about what she's doing. And Matthew, because I brought you up, go ahead and just tell us who you are and tell us where you're coming from and kind of what I do.
All right.
Maybe having the beer up here is a bad idea. Think about the panel fail.
So, yeah, my name is Matthew Meschery. I'm the Director of Digital Initiatives at the Independent Television Service. ITVS, if you don't know who we are, we're a funding and presenting organization. We're kind of the intermediary between independent filmmakers and public television, or PBS. And I'm the Director of Digital, which means I oversee new media content, and transmedia, which we'll explain a little bit more later.
Should I go ahead? Okay. So I'm Michella Rivera-Gravage, and I work at the Center for Asian American Media, CAAM. So we're based in San Francisco, and our football team, or something that we're kind of most visibly known for, is the San Francisco International Asian American Film Festival. We have the largest Asian American Film Festival in the States. So I'm the Director of Digital and Interactive Media, so I oversee almost all web content, any interactive content, apps, games, and social media.
My name is Hannah Eaves. I'm the VP of Digital and Engagement at LinkTV, which is a national satellite broadcaster on Dish and DirecTV in about 35 million US households. And we do a lot of digital projects. We show world cinema, documentaries, international global news. And we are a nonprofit, and we get funded for a lot of kind of transmedia type website projects where we collect together collections of videos. And I'll show you some of those a bit later.
My name is Katie Gillum. I help run the Disposable Film Fest. It's a film fest that is located mostly in San Francisco. The core sort of impetus of the film fest is both celebrating and finding really interesting media that's made on what we consider disposable cameras. And so that the name came from a disposable video camera that was on the market very briefly 5 years ago, but the whole idea is it's all media that is incredibly accessible. So it's the things that you have in your pockets, things that are made on like web cameras, flip cameras, mobile phones. So we're in our fifth year, and we are seeing increasingly professional in the storytelling sense type of films still using really non-professional media. So I'm really excited to see what everyone else is showing here. The other thing that we really focus on is telling stories in, as Santhosh was saying, sort of new sort of advocacy and non-profit spaces. So that's something that we'll be talking about a little later too.
And you did have a selection here at the festival that showed yesterday, right?
Yes.
Okay.
actually. Do you want to use this?
Hello.
Hi, my name is Tanya Vlach. I'm an interactive experimental artist and producer. I am wearing a prosthetic eye, and right now I'm embarking on transforming my prosthetic eye into a camera. So I recently raised some preliminary funds through Kickstarter to build a breadboard to build a camera that will be implanted in my prosthesis. This project has a transmedia component to it, where it will be live streaming on the internet, on the web. There's also a documentary film being built, made around it. I have a script that I'm writing, and I'm really interested in augmentation and redefining disability. So that's me in a nutshell.
No, well, thank you, everybody. That was a very good introduction to all of you. And Tanya, we are going to use that explanation from Tanya to sort of just leap into your project right now. And rather than have you talk about it, let's, if you don't mind queuing up the piece up there, I think it'll be good for all of you to see really what she's talking about, or actually see what she sees.
That show in the 70s, huh? Not a one of them. The $6 million man, now a San Francisco woman, once what she considers, or some consider, a bionic eye, like the one Steve Austin had. He could see forever in that show. Tanya Vlach lost her eye back in a car accident in 2005. Now she wants a webcam fitted into her eye socket. Is it possible? Where could it lead? Fox Metal contributor Dr. Jennifer Ashton with me now. Doctor, good morning to you.
Good morning, Bill.
I know you were too young to remember.
And here is what space there is available for a camera, and it will be quite a challenge to fit that all the technology that needs to go in there. I'm interested in creating something new. This would entail a video camera and still camera that would feed wirelessly into an external device, and creating a specific app that could also be used as a remote to control the functionality of the camera, and all the while being able to see what I can see through the camera eye onto my device. So in that sense, it is true augmented vision or augmented reality. I discovered in a very traumatic and jarring way that you can lose life quickly and without warning. Coming back into the living, I wanted to really savor life. Those moments that you take for granted became intentional markers of memories for me. This is why I posted a call to engineers to build a miniature camera to be implanted in my prosthetic eye. The response stunned me. It was an international curiosity. Also, I had unintentionally triggered a dialogue about what it meant to be human.
So that's Tanya's project, and I have to say it's been one of the more compelling things that I've seen in many years. And there's a lot of things that I know that probably people in the audience want to ask about it, but I also just want to really quickly ask you a question. Also going off of something that Matthew said, you've defined this as a transmedia project. For everybody out here, everybody may know, but maybe you could just talk about what you mean by that when you say transmedia. And for all of you also, if you can jump in, maybe to help explain that too, or define it, that might be good.
Well, I'm not actually really sure what transmedia means, but my background is in the arts. I started dancing at an early age. I was a writer, photographer. Never could stick with one medium. Was kind of schizophrenic with mediums. Before my accident, I had self-described myself as a transdisciplinary artist because I wanted to be a performer and I was also doing live video projections. So this particular project is focused on media, so I feel like it's a good way to describe it. The way I think about transmedia is that there are multiple platforms part of the project. While there's going to be a website and we're going to have a web series showing the making of an iCamera and then also showing short videos of what I see from my own eye. So, and that's also going to be largely interactive. My project really came about while it was my own idea. It was I kept moving forward because there was a large one-eyed community through the internet that wrote to me and said that they were really inspired by this. They used my blog as a forum to talk about how they lost their eye and what they would like to do with their eye. And so that's what made me continue with it. So that's one aspect is the internet presence. There's also going to be an app. For me, as a remote, so I can control the camera, but also a way for it to be streaming so other people can see what I'm seeing. And then there is a documentary being made about the project by Phoebe Took, who's a filmmaker in San Francisco. I have a background in writing, and I want to make sure that there is text that supports all of this media, transmedia shenanigans. I don't know.
No, that's a good explanation. And I don't know if anybody wanted to add anything to that. No? Okay. So I'm going to ask you, so I know what stage this project is in, and I have just a very blunt question for you. Is that actually possible, what you've proposed up there?
Yes. I will make it happen. There is another man who is doing the same project in Canada, and he's much further along. So I know that it is possible. I also know he has a much bigger eye than I do. So it's going to be harder to make the technology small enough to fit in my prosthesis. With Moore's Law and the advancement of technology, I have no doubt that it is possible. I do want to have a medical consultant on my team because I don't want to have any problems in the future. I've had enough surgeries. I've had enough problems in my life. I want to make sure it's healthy for me. Did I answer your question?
Definitely. So I think that question has always come to mind when I look at it too, because you know it leads in with a bionic man. And in that they say we now have the technology. Back then they didn't have the technology, and I think it's sort of a curiosity to know, do we have that technology now? Does anybody have any questions in the audience? Because this is going to be just sort of an interplay between us and everybody else, so I don't want to restrict it to questions at the very end, but if anybody has something they want to ask, go ahead. No, okay.
Can we ask a question?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
The question was, do you have a prototype yet? And
not yet. I've had several different engineers come forward, and I've even approached the MIT Media Lab. I do not have a solid engineering team as of yet.
The question I have is obviously there's a lot of people like doing live streaming and you know Justin TV. And what do you think would be the qualitative difference between you know versus like having a camera on your hat versus, you know, having a prosthesis?
Right. So as you mentioned, Justin TV, and there was like the Truman Show and Ed TV. There's plenty of storylines working with Sue's Valence or like wearing a camera on your head. I found Justin TV dreadfully boring. it was just like, you know, he was mostly working on his computer. There was no storyline. I believe that with this technology, it's also a new craft, and I really encourage artists to come in and start creating their own work and have sort of an auteur perspective in what you're making, even if it is live.
I was wondering, how are you going to let people know that you interact with, that you have a camera, you know? I mean, do you think about recording their image or whatever?
That's a tough one.
Make them sign releases.
What?
Make them sign releases when you talk
yeah,
to them.
I mean, there's a lot of different ways I've been thinking about it. So you had asked, how will I let people know that I'm filming them on camera? It is a very controversial issue because of privacy and... you know, people wanting to know if they're being recorded. Although we are living in a heavy camera culture society right now. There are cameras on all the time. so there are different ways that I've thought about letting people know. One of them is just like wearing a t-shirt saying you're on camera, or having sort of a film shoot sort of situation where it's blocked off. I'm still not sure yet.
Are you going to be tempted to create fictionalized versions of your life, like mixing
truthiness?
truth or fiction?
Truthiness. I'm a big fan of truthiness.
Okay, well, I guess that was the answer. So, you know, I know that you just had a Kickstarter campaign,
yes.
And I know that you know what I was going to ask you this, is how are you funding this? Okay, dude, I should... Just you don't have to go into as much detail as you want or little as detail as you want, but I think it's sort of interesting how this kind of thing works because you are an artist, you are working independently, right? You have no sponsor, you have no sort of funding body behind you, but you're doing this by yourself and with the help of friends. And so how are you doing that though?
A lot of sleepless nights. So yeah, it's been a total volunteer effort. I had applied for certain art grants, but it doesn't seem to fit into certain categories. I think we're getting closer to that. But recently I had launched a Kickstarter campaign and was able to raise over $15,000, which was my goal. So that was through crowdsourcing. And I decided that that was a really good way to go because of the amount of activity through my blog and international interest, other one-eyeds around the world, engineers, people who are interested in this kind of technology. So crowdsourcing, I'm going to probably continue to work in that vein. I'm also looking for funders. I will be applying for more grants. And if anybody has any other ideas, come talk to me afterwards, please.
Another question.
Oh, yeah, go ahead.
Yep. I'm the big guy standing here. Right. So a big fan of, you know, changing the whole paradigm on storytelling. And I was just telling somebody a few minutes ago that watching a movie today is like watching a silent film in the era of talkies. It's absolutely ridiculous how far behind, not technology is, but the creative and the talented people are, right? And it's... We have to kind of, you know, shock the system into change, and there's really no other way to do it. So the question is, and by the way, this is not an offer to invest from my side, but my question is, if you had the capital you needed, and if you had the team that you needed, right, what's the first thing that you would do that would make a change, make a difference, and also make a lot of money? Tell me about that.
Oh, my goodness. Well, There is a big shift right now with people with disabilities and technology and bionics, and I find it's incredibly inspiring. I don't know if you've heard of Amy Mullins. She's a paraplegic, and she did something similar where she put a call out to engineers, and now she has 8 versions of legs. Even a fashion designer created these really beautiful boots for her. That's something that I would like to be a part of in affecting that kind of change is redefining disability. People who feel like they haven't had a voice or they're embarrassed about their life, I want them to feel like that they can create their own version of their of self and identity. And then making money. I have a big one-eyed fan base. I know a bunch of one-eyed people are out there, and I know I could reach globally and internationally even more, who are very interested in this kind of product.
Okay, cool, thanks. By the way, I do believe there's lots of things you can do that can make a change and also make a lot of money. So I'm a big believer.
Let's talk after.
Absolutely, thanks.
That was a great question. It's sort of hard to define it that way, and it's hard. I know it's hard for you to maybe look at it that way, but I think that's sort of a good point to sort of say, you know, where is the public audience for that, or where is the audience point? I think that's, Matthew, that's kind of what you were asking too, how it differentiates itself to draw people in. If you don't mind, I want to go back to one thing you said and then sort of use that as a point to sort of jump over to Katie over here. You mentioned something about crowdsourcing and how that's really important, and I think that's sort of a fundamental, it's a tenet of Disposable too, if I'm correct, right? And I think for everybody here. And maybe the two of you could just quickly talk about sort of how you go about that and maybe lead into Katie and what how Disposable works in terms of crowdsourcing.
Okay. Because I, you know, after my accident, I learned how to blog. I had a bunch of downtime, and I was like, wow, there's this whole internet world out there, and they really wanted to talk, and they really wanted to connect. So I became really geeky at that point, and so I'm very avid on Facebook. I got a lot more versatile on Twitter with my campaign, and that was a very good way to crowdsource, is just to get it out there. I do believe in also having events. It's different, but I think it's important to be meeting people face-to-face outside of the internet. And then having those people who fund it or who are interested in the project posting it, and then people will find it that way. Anyway, that's what I did.
Well, I think it's interesting thinking about the Disposable Film Fest as crowdsourcing, because, I mean, everyone has a camera, so that's the crowd, right? The crowd is everyone that has a camera, which is probably everyone in this room several times over. And the reason that it's important to not think of the Disposable Film Fest as every type of other film fest, and it's important for us as we are about to close our submissions to think about that, because people don't know that they're filmmakers when they have those cameras in their pockets. Like, it's not, you know that you have a camera, and you know you can take a picture of your cute niece, and send it to your, you know, to the other people that think she's cute. But I think the important thing that we find is you have to tell people that the things that they're making are interesting enough to put in front of an audience. And we're constantly working, and it sort of hinted at this a little bit before, but we are working with things that are sometimes already been shown on, have already have many views on YouTube, or you know, not that many views on Vimeo, depending on, you know, what it is. And we both encourage people to submit, but also go out and look for people that are making interesting things using these forms of media. And there is a little bit of the sort of educational work that you have to do, is like, this is actually a very interesting story that you're telling, and we would like to show it, not outside of the sort of individual one-on-one interaction with it that someone will have in YouTube, or maybe, you know, 1 on 20 when people have little YouTube parties, but and put it in like in front of on a big screen and treat it as the real sort of art and story that it was when you made it. You just may not have thought that it was actually something that needed to go on a big screen. So the crowdsourcing is a lot more about encouraging people taking their creativity and sort of finishing it and thinking of it as a final product. And I think that's something that I think is happening probably everyone in this
panels think about that is like people are a lot of it's the reason that it's interesting to be here in Palo Alto. People have been doing things that they have been sort of experimenting with and thinking of as like a side project. But they're actually really sort of, if they can focus on it and think about it as a story, it can be meaningful to share with other people. And that's the type of crowdsourcing we do, which, you know, technically that's done by mostly meeting people in person and finding out what other things that they're doing. And doing a lot of chasing up sort of an interesting idea that we see on YouTube and saying, what are the other things that people are making on this? And sometimes we tweet about like, hey, has anyone seen this? Or does anyone know this filmmaker? We're trying to find them. So it's a lot more, it's like talent finding. Yeah, it's like Star Search on Vimeo. But I actually have a question that this for Tanya here. Is it all right if I start a question? That sort of, I was thinking as you were talking about this, that the theme for, or the, I guess the tagline for Disposable Film Festival this year was called Turn Your Camera On. And part of what we were thinking about with that is that like everyone has a camera, but frequently you're not thinking about turning it on. And so people have it sort of attached to their hip and they sort of think of their camera, their phone, their, you know, whatever they have as part of them. But you are making a camera that will be in you. And I'm wondering if you still think of, like right now when you're taking a picture or you're thinking about video, do you think of that as part of you? Are you, like, are you internalizing that video, or is it still gonna be something that you're controlling and, you know, turning off and on and treating as a camera? It just happens to be like you have the POV sort of, you know, in your hands or your head.
Thank you for that question. let's see. I think I'm going to be doing a lot of different things. I think I'm going to be experimenting a whole hell of a lot. But I will be intense. I'll be intent about what I'm doing. But I'm also interested in just letting it run and seeing what happens. So I'm just, I can't wait for it to happen and just do, make stuff.
Katie, do you mind if I ask you to show everyone here what Disposable is? Because I think that was a really great lead into what you do, especially sort of leading in from you, Tanya, because it seems like there's a definite synergy in terms of what you both do. Sure.
I'm just going to show a couple clips. I thought I'd start with the film that actually won this year's competitive shorts program, the 2011 competitive shorts program. It's just it's a 5-minute film, and you can find all of our work on our Vimeo channel. So pretty much all of it's up. We post it one film a week after the festival premieres every year. This film is a really interesting explanation of what we think of as disposable, because the whole point of disposable film, the whole idea of it, is that making interesting things with whatever camera equipment you have on hand. And in the past, that's been mostly flip cameras and webcams. And this year, we actually got a lot of very interesting films made on stills. And they are real films. They're not slideshows. They're films. And so this one actually won. It is all stills, and it won the whole program. So let me just start it. One second. So it's just the first 2 minutes.
A blip, a second. Half a second. That's how much a photo used to catch. A tiny blip. There used to be stilted set-up scenes where everyone may as well have been statues, or fake bullet points of holidays, birthdays, Christmases, achievements. You had your roll of film, and you hoped for the best. But now, with the birth of the internet and digital cameras, they capture, well, everything. You take 100 and delete the ones you don't want. The unflattering ones. The embarrassing ones, the useless ones, and the ones that tell the truth. So all you're left with is the perfect picture. This is me and Ruby. This is the last picture we ever took together. Look at it. You'd never know. And this is the first. Donnie's house party. And that's Donnie there in the middle, grinning away like the retard he is. She was being chatted up by this Mexican dick. As soon as I arrived, I couldn't take my eyes off her, but I couldn't get close to her as my ex-girlfriend was there. Samantha, bitch. But the night continued, drinks were drunk, and we finally got talking. She was a model. We talked about our childhoods, where we studied, our dreams, everything. We clicked. This was it. The first 6 months, it was perfection. But as our love grew, so did our insecurities. I was jealous of all her exes. She didn't like how close I was with Michelle from work. We started arguing over little things at first, but then they became more personal, more vicious. On the day this photo was taken, we broke up. I'm not sure who suggested it, but we both wanted it.
So that's just the first half. It continues. And I think the reason it's interesting to look at it is the most like a professionally produced film that we've ever shown. It is, in terms of the storyboarding, in terms of the just the arc and the shoot that they did, all of those scenes were set up. I mean, some of the pictures of him as a child and her as a child were obviously sourced in the same way you would source if you were making a short film for a festival. And but the reason that they told the story that way is they didn't have access to a video camera. And they ended up telling a story that was actually much more interesting and had the medium of as the story goes on, he turns and he starts stalking her. And it fits perfectly because this idea of like a stalker tracking someone and the actual medium of stills worked really well with that. And I think the reason it resonated and it won is that it is the first time that this sort of more professional filmmaking process has been so disposable. And it was a nice camera, but it wasn't. It was something they just borrowed from someone's aunt. So it was ultimately very disposable from that. And two other really quick clips, shorter than this, that I wanted to show. One, this is a little bit more in the vein of a lot of the stuff that we get. It's called While You Were Out, and the reason I find it incredibly interesting is it's stop motion. It's also done with stills, but it's a stop motion that a lot of people do a lot of experimentation. But in this situation, the medium again is part of the story. You start seeing where this experimentation took place. You can find a geographic place. You can figure out sort of the work that's happening there. And there's some interesting notepads that are used. So I'll let you guys watch this minute and. Talk about it afterwards. Interesting story with this one, which may not have been clear. You guys couldn't, if you're not from the Portland or Vancouver area, you wouldn't be able to look up where the 503 area code is. But if you start watching this, it becomes a story of a taxi dispatcher just spending. Obviously, there's a lot of themes of like trying to stay awake, drugs, coffee, and the story. I really like the Gardasil for people that are women's health advocates. There's just a really interesting story of what it's like to be a radio dispatcher, an overnight radio dispatcher that. Ends up being told through this interesting stop motion. That goes on, you can see that online too. I can show another one later, but we can also just move on if you wanted to. Should we show one more minute? What does the crowd think? All right, great. Okay, cool. So this one is actually the farthest extension to having the medium of producing film be the film. It's It's just 1 minute clip of a music video for a local band. Let's see where it is. There it is. And you will see what I mean by the medium being the film. Pretty immediately. That feels like a tease. I'm realizing now I'm just getting into the bridges. But we didn't only get films that are the medium telling the story, but I thought this was a particularly interesting in the transmedia conversation that we also get cat videos. We get very funny cat videos. I would encourage you to check them out. But they're all things that are sort of exist online mostly already. We get people making things because of the disposable film idea, but we also find things that already exist, people doing really interesting things, already telling a really interesting story with what they have. And in this situation, they had a laptop and could screen capture, and it's really exciting to think about. It actually starts telling a very interesting story of the late night video editor stalking his film subjects, which is... for video editors in the audience, that happens. All right.
Yeah, that's awesome. That was those were great clips. But I'm not going to let you get away that quickly. I want you to quickly tell us how this all came about, and because I'm really curious about it too. Because I actually know about you because I think I was walking down through SoMa in San Francisco on 9th Street, and I was 7th or something, and I saw some of this stuff being projected, I think, from a bicycle on the side of a building. Okay, and that's how I know about it. And then from there, it just sort of generated into all these different places. And I see you guys in all these smaller spaces. I know you have this online component. I know you also have an exhibition component. Obviously, you're here at the festival. But where did this all come from? And you know, I think we should know. We have to know.
I had no idea that's actually how you first heard about it. So what Santhosh is describing is the bike-in screenings, which became part of the festival 2.5 years ago. So we had our third bike-in screening in May. And what that is the idea about the Disposable Film Festival is that it's accessible and that it's something that anyone can do if they have a story. The idea of a bike-in was something I think probably everyone in this room probably grew up with getting to go to drive-in films. And there was a real social aspect to that. There was you'd park your car, and if you were with your family, then you'd as quickly as possible go get popcorn so you could get away from your family and go hang out with the cool kids near the popcorn machine. But there was the social aspects to public viewing, and there's part of that when we screen in big theaters, in big sort of cinemas. But the sort of festival community aspect to that is something that biking to a festival and being outdoors and being next to each other really it both sort of emulates what it was like to be at a drive-in, but also builds on it in a way that you're not actually separated from people by these large vehicles. And the other thing is that we want to give as the entire staff really of the Disposable Film Fest. No one owns cars, and we all cycle. And so, I know it's very San Francisco. Everyone's doing that. We also do very well in Portland, you might imagine. Because we don't really own cars and we bike around, we wanted to. It's not awesome even in San Francisco because you go and you bike someplace, and like the places where there are to go see films are in some of the most highly trafficked, like the highest bike stealing sort of areas in San Francisco. And so we always partner with bike valets. There's always someone there watching the bike valets, and they often happen to be bike mechanics, and they can help you tune up your stuff. So it's trying to make a social event out of sort of a very social and sort of active event out of a public space. And the way that actually that got started was that we all rode bikes. But the festival itself started in 2007 when the founders, Carlton and Eric, were talking about giving a public place to screen these sort of more private type videos. And at the same time, I actually had just met them. I was working in Ireland on teaching sort of, you could call it disposable, teaching filmmaking and storytelling with small groups of like young mothers and ex-cons and things to do the exact same sort of thing. And so we'd been keeping in touch with each other's projects until I moved back here. And so it's, and I brought some more of the educational focus to that. So it's sort of been building into a little bit more of an educational and event thing since about 2007. That's it.
Yeah, that's a good history. I don't know if it was on your website, but I think, you should. Okay, well, based on the concept of disposable, I actually did have a question maybe for all of you guys. And that's whether or not, there's a lot of different ways to make media right now. And, does our ability to create so much imagery, so much content, really make it irrelevant or just make it disposable? And I know that's not the purpose of what you're trying to say, but the reason I bring it up is because Michelle and I, you and I had a conversation earlier this week about now the type of work that you're doing over at CAAM. And one of your projects is specifically about not considering anything kind of disposable, but actually preserving film. And you're actually stepping back into history with some of the stuff that you're doing to go back and get footage of things that are found footage and revamp them and re-present them. And so it's just a question that I'm sort of putting out there for everybody, but maybe, Michelle, you could start with answering it and then maybe show sort of what you were talking about.
Okay. May I use that? Thank you. Okay, so yeah, the project that Santhosh is mentioning, we're just in the preliminary stages of doing a project called Memories to Light, Asian American Home Movie Project. So basically, we recognize that there, being in the Bay Area, there's a wealth of home movie, a repository of home movie stuff that we haven't really tapped into. And specifically when we say home movie, we're talking about Super 8 and 16 millimeter regular 8 millimeter film. And so we wanted to kind of take a new media approach towards these older formats and sort of give them another life. I think we really recognized from some works in sort of our history of Asian American media making, sort of the power of the power of home movie. And Rick Prelinger, who does something called Lost Landscapes in San Francisco, and he's actually done one on Detroit too, he kind of describes home movie is both simultaneously populist but not simplistic. And so it's something where we wanted to go back to the community, look at media that maybe, it reminded me of some of the things that you were saying, that like people weren't necessarily thinking themselves as media makers or filmmakers, but still being able to, one, go back to that media and see what stories could be told, whether it was looking at a city through a different community lens or a historical period, and not only sharing that with just showing that footage, but also sharing it with, another group of media makers as well to be either inspired or possibly collaborate on a piece later. So there's this aspect that's about community and social engagement. So we'll sort of have these community events where we're going to be kind of showing different works that have used home movies in the work to kind of tell the story of the Asian American experience, and then also ask people to bring their media or actually contact us so that we can digitize the work and then include it in an online archive. So there is this online component of it, there's a social interactive component, and then we also have the film festival, which I mentioned. So we would have screenings as well that will be sort of more curated events of the footage that we've come across. We're going to partner with other organizations that work more directly with communities to kind of get the ball rolling and getting people to submit works and talk about home movies and the power of home movies. So one of the things I was going to show to just kind of illustrate this project is for our 30th anniversary, we commissioned folks to do all kinds of works about Asian American media. And so it was our 30th anniversary. We asked them to do a 30-second piece. And there's one particular work done by a filmmaker, Gita Patel, who I think you guys work with too, right? Who did a work based on home movie footage that I think is very powerful. So I'm just going to show that.
What do you want to know?
Yeah, hold on one second. Okay. Say check.
When I went to America, I was the first one. The day I was leaving, it was like getting married. The whole town was involved. So many people cried. I never cried. During first time Pacho Avio, so many people came to my airport to receive me. And I entered the town, through the whole town, they came.
I think I stopped it early, but anyways, you get the idea. So, you know, another component of it sort of later in the second year is that we'll want to both work with folks, new media makers, as well as filmmakers to potentially make works about the footage that we find and work, of course, with the people that have shared their home movies.
So the what you're doing with this, though, is actually, and this is something that you pointed out to me earlier on this week, is that it's sort of part of a larger perspective of your digital initiatives that about, am I correct in sort of giving films a different kind of lifespan or an enhanced lifespan? Because I think you told me a lot about how there was, you know, there's a lot of things to learn in all these conversations, and one of them was about thinking about how digital technology takes the things that we already know and gives them sort of a new dimension that we can then use and give it a lifespan beyond what we thought it would have. And I think that you were telling me about the film, a documentary. Sacred Mountain, right?
Oh, or yeah. The documentary is actually called Daughters of Everest, but the game that we're building based on the documentary is called Climbing Sacred Mountain.
Okay, so maybe you could just, do you mind just talking about that, sort of how that works? Because Daughters of Everest it's a documentary that's from, what, 2 years ago? Or is it an older documentary?
It's from 2005, yeah.
Okay, even more so, okay. Mm-hmm. But it's a game that you're developing now, mm-hmm. some 6 years later. So maybe you can just sort of talk about that. And
sure. A similarity between the two projects and kind of what I think we're tasked to do in the digital and interactive media department is, one, be able to... So in some ways, we felt that people didn't really know necessarily about home movies or the potential power of home movies or the way to use home movies to tell stories. And I think that's fundamentally what we're about, regardless of platform or medium. But so that was something that we're trying to do. We see that the social engagement events as a way to sort of bring new people and make connections across generation using home movie. And that's something that we're also trying to do with the game Climbing Sacred Mountain, which is based on a documentary by Sapna Sakya called Daughters of Everest, which is about the first Nepali women's expedition up Mount Everest. So I'm just going to show a clip of that demos the game. So we have a prototype that we built. It's just a very simple prototype. Now we're looking at how we're going to integrate the video footage within the game, and then also deepen the game mechanic and sort of game design. So that's the stage that we're on now. We're working on our next iteration of it.
Dickie Sherpa wants to try out for the team.
In my own way, I'm trying my best. You know? Though not as strong as them. So, I want to try.
Dawa, or Monday, is the youngest member.
My name is Dawa. I'm a solo kumbu kumju. I'm a school that's home. I'm a garbanda. I'm a garbanda.
So to stop it there, yeah.
Sure. You know, does anybody out there have any questions? I know that I sort of we skipped over that part, but does anybody have any questions they want to ask at this point? Okay. You know, I have a question for you, and it's probably a question that's going to lead to all three of you, Hannah, Matthew, and Michella. You know, I've been following what you guys do for a long time, and I've noticed that, you know, you have a traditional festival model, but you've also, you know, you focus primarily on television for the previous years in terms of funding and what you've been doing. But now you have a position in an organization that has traditionally focused on one kind of exhibition and one kind of distribution and support, but you're focusing now on these type of works. And maybe you could just tell us sort of why, as an organization, that's something that's become important for Center for Asian American Media to do. And I think it probably leads right into Hannah, too, on that, because I've got the same question for you, too.
Okay, yeah. So the reason why specifically we're doing this game is to get the story and the message of the piece. So the game is really focused on sort of leadership and girl empowerment and sort of education, multicultural education. So we wanted to be able to use, you know, certain ideas from the film and get it to another audience, because it's an older piece, but also a younger audience. The game is targeted towards 8 to 11-year-olds, girls specifically. And there's a real dearth of, I would say, quality games for girls, or games that have, you know, positive representations of women or girls. So that's another sort of goal of the game. So so that's why we're specifically doing Climbing Sacred Mountain. I think in general the organization is doing more digital and interactive media, I mean, quite frankly, for the survival of the organization. I mean, our festival is still doing well. We still, we work really closely with public television. We're also a liaison for Asian American filmmakers to public television. So those are still going strong, but you know, I think we just have to diversify to other audiences, like people are, you know, who are watching things primarily online, people who are spending more time playing games than watching things on television, or going to film festivals. You know, I ask my students all the time, do you go to film festivals? And at least for our, you know, maybe your festival seems a lot younger audience. So that's really great. But in general, I mean, because there's an opportunity that people they know or they are actually showing works. So I think that just for our survival, we have to sort of be able to be in the spaces and places that our community and our audiences are actually. And then, you know, I would say first and foremost about storytelling. And so it's kind of exciting to me that there's these new ways of telling stories through these either different platforms or connecting different platforms to make a whole story using different components.
I think that's an important point to make, because you know, it is a future. It's kind of where things are going. And I don't know, Hannah, what do you think about that? And Hannah, you can sort of quickly explain like how LinkTV works. I don't know if all of you have seen LinkTV, but it's a pretty profound organization. So.
So I mean, obviously, the future of television is digital. So I think the writing's on the wall for that one. So I think that's the direction we're heading in as much as possible. I mean, we see, particularly, you know, we're a US network. But we see a massive international growth in visits to our website and people who are who can see kind of what kind of content that we're offering by looking at the website, and all of them want to engage and use that content. And so, you know, using digital platforms is a great way of engaging that audience. Plus, I think you're kind of referring also to the fact that we show a lot of really powerful documentaries that inspire people to learn more and want to take action around the issues covered in the documentaries or even in global news. And they want to know how they can do that. And we can do a little bit of that through television, you know, pointing people, you see it, how to give to the Red Cross during this emergency or something like that. But there's a whole new opportunity online or through applications where you can really connect people to impactful ways that they can do something about what they've just seen at the moment that they're most inspired to do that, which is after they've seen a powerful story. So I think that also, you know, is so clearly in our mission People can learn more, they can take action, they can do all of that through this digital experience.
Yeah, and I think that, and obviously you know I'm going to ask you this, but you have the View Change program that's funded by the Gates Foundation, and it's in your description of it, and I'm just going to read it off what it says, and I'm sorry that I'm doing that, but it says View Change combines the best global development video stories and groundbreaking new technology to enable individuals and organizations to stimulate change. I think it's kind of what you were talking about, and I think that's kind of what Michella was alluding to. Can you show, just maybe if you can just show sort of what that means, because it sounds really, it sounds interesting. I don't know that it's something we can visualize without the
examples. Yeah, so basically, you know, we had a few meetings with the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and we talked a little bit about the landscape around global development videos. You know, there's a lot of really interesting work happening in the developing world, but a lot of it is in very deep silos. You know, the UN has this content, and these guys have this content. And if you are a journalist or a policymaker in DC, and you want to, you know, show your congressperson a video about this great new technology in a certain country, it's just always has been really hard to find that kind of powerful media to tell those stories. So we were kind of tasked with doing a stock take of all of the landscape of people that had this kind of media, and then bring it all together. And then we also did an online film contest where we got submissions from all around the world. I think over 100 different countries were represented with the submissions. So there was also kind of a user-generated disposable film contest kind of element to that. And then we brought them all together into this digital platform. And then we did one more step, which is that while these libraries also, you know, existed, the UN and, you know, these content from health people, just regular people in Rwanda, for instance, existed as separate content libraries, so did lots of other things on the web. You know, there's the New York Times is like a silo, or there are ways that you can take action are like silos. So what is the technology that's possibly there to bring together these things? And so we basically created the View Change as a big mashup. So what it does is it analyzes the transcript of the video, and it uses that to do a live search for other related content online that might be relevant to that video, as well as ways to take action. And it also automatically brings all of the videos into these kinds of collections. So what it does is it looks at the description and the transcript and does natural language processing, and it automatically pulls out, you know, this is about Turkey, or this is about the country Turkey versus the bird Turkey. This is a video about a certain type of crop in this African country. And then it does a live search for other related content around that video. So I think I have a... So here's part of our technology collection. We have 430 videos in the whole collection, 45 of them around technology. It also uses this intelligence system to suggest what you might want to narrow down by. So you might want to narrow down by technology and change makers. So you're seeing people that are making change through technology. And then if you take a look at an individual video, we can take a look at this one. You can see which segments are most relevant to the search that you're doing. But and then you can also just take a look at the video. And the video is surrounded itself by more videos on View Change. Oops. Related videos on View Change. Related videos from elsewhere on the web. So, you know, what if the... I don't want to be US-centric here, but what if the Wall Street Journal or CNN has a great video about this that we don't have the rights to, that we haven't acquired? We can still link out to that related video. Similarly, here we have news stories from around the web of, you know, for instance, allafrica.com has an article on this technology. So we're linking out to all of these. And normally what you'd have to do is someone would manually curate this. Someone would sit down and do a search, and those links would then die over time. They become less relevant. But the nice thing with this system is that the moment that you're looking at the video, it does a live search to come up with this related content. And then there's ways that you can take action. Oh, I keep on doing that. There's ways that you can take action based on what you see in the video. And then this is all embeddable
And what's interesting about the embeddability is that you can also include all the related articles, videos, and more. So if you're a blogger and you've embedded this video, in 2 years' time, someone might Google and come across your blog post. But because we have this related video, the related content underneath it, that will update the moment that person discovers your blog post. So that keeps it constantly fresh and alive. So that's kind of the basics of what we built. And then we open sourced that technology. So this is basically a video content management system that we developed, and then we released it on GitHub, which is an open source repository. And then we built a new website using the same technology called Link News. So this is all global news videos. What's also interesting about the technology is that we built the ability to play YouTube videos, curate YouTube videos just like we've put them in ourselves. So this is a YouTube video. Here you see it's on YouTube, but it plays within our player with our controls. And we've expanded here the related information. So now we're including even capsule information. Again, this is automatically assigned to this video based on the transcript. So riot's not a great example, but Romani people, sure, you might not know much about the Romani people, especially if you're a younger person. And here you get a little bit of information about why you should care about that. And then we have, again, action, articles, and related videos. So that's repurposing the same technology for this new website.
So how does a site like this compare to, you know, other broadcast television sites? And I don't mean Matthew's site.
Well, I think that one of the most unique pieces of it is our willingness to link out to other content providers. I mean, I think that most broadcasters are very want to keep people on their site. They're very much around their own programming, their own content. But we're more of an issue-based organization. We have a mission, and that's to inform people. So we are happy to link out to videos no matter where they're coming from. Also articles, ways to take action. And we have a little bit more because we're independent. We're allowed to connect advocacy with video in a way that public television can't. Public television has a lot of rules because they receive taxpayer money when it comes to advocacy. And we don't have those same kinds of restrictions. Also, I think we talked about this a little bit, even some of the digital solutions that are out there, like a Netflix or an HBO Go, a lot of them are trying to just replicate the television viewing experience, even through their applications. They're not thinking through a lot of what else can you bring to the media experience. I think that's something that we think about a lot.
But so why do you think that is, though? Because that's sort of the opposite of what Michella was saying, right? That she's saying in order to remain relevant and competitive in this environment, that's something that you do need to do, but now you're saying the exact opposite, that that's happening. Some people aren't doing that. And why do you think the...
Well, personally, I think it's because they want to keep their consumers in their comfort zone. So, you know, that the reason they want to be very clear that this is the lean back experience, this is the 10-foot experience. So I'm going to make it as much like television as possible. And that way, you know, my mother-in-law is going to be comfortable with the idea of consuming things digitally because it's so much like the experience that she's already had. And they do experiment with synced, for instance, like synced iPad applications and things like that to deliver related content around programming for the kind of advanced viewer. But it's not the norm. And I think that I have a feeling they're probably developed in other parts of those companies. So anyway.
You mentioned something about the restrictions of public broadcast and funding. And I guess that Matthew, I'm just going to go ahead and have you talk because I think there's a lot that we could ask you there about that. But just go ahead and tell us sort of something about ITVS and what you're doing over there.
Good. Yeah, I think that first of all, I'm a big fan of Hannah's project, and if there are any geeks in the room, you should have her tell you more about the back end because the semantic back end is really powerful. And I'm jealous, actually. Yes. At ITVS, as I said, we're kind of the intermediary between independent film community and PBS or public television. And I think that, you know, what Michella said about why we're kind of investing in terms of in digital content is exactly right. It's, you know, this is for the survival of kind of our organization, but also filmmakers. You know, we know that independent filmmakers, if you look at the history of cinema, it's always been sort of the outsiders of the independents that have been able to innovate. And we want to be able to kind of support that, be able to kind of support that culture within the independent community, where there's a lot of, there's a lot of hunger and a lot of enthusiasm for doing kind of new forms of storytelling and to work with digital media, which is exciting. And then also the second part of our mission is to bring kind of underserved stories, underserved voices and unheard stories to the public. And if you're an independent filmmaker and on public television, you don't have kind of the big budget that Hollywood has to reach, you know, the you know, a large amount of people. So you have to be smarter. And one way of being smarter is to use kind of these new tools to engage audiences in kind of a deeper way. And so that's really also another reason that we're kind of invested in that. But I do want to go, I mean, I can show a couple things.
Yeah, I think you should. Some of the stuff you're doing is great. I mean, like everyone's,
But I do want to go back to the idea, because we want to kind of bring it back to this concept of transmedia and what is transmedia. And I think it really does have to do with, you know, it's not just about thinking of the, you know, certainly there's going to be, you know, very soon on the television side, broadcast and kind of internet distribution are going to merge. Or they're going to be, you know, it's going to be more seamless. And broadcasters, because they're kind of protecting their old revenue model, are really thinking about it as just another pipe to serve up content. And so, as well as other platforms. And so when you think about kind of just multi-platform distribution, it's not about taking, you know, it's you could take, you know, 1 hour long program and distribute it on multiple platforms, but that's not transmedia. Transmedia is really about taking a story and spreading it across multiple platforms and leveraging those platforms for what they do best to enhance the story. So I think that's kind of the differentiator. And if you go, I don't know if any of you, anyone here know who Henry Jenkins is. You should check him out. He has a blog, Henry Jenkins. He's a professor at USC, and he's kind of came up with he came up with the term transmedia. And so there's now this big debate because it's kind of this buzzword. Yeah. And so there's transmedia branding, like the advertising industry is really like locked onto it. And so there's, in a couple of his blog posts, he really talks about, you know, kind of how he defines it. But, you know, one element, so one thing that comes up is, does transmedia have to be participatory? So I'll show you an example of something that ITVS funded about 5 years ago, and we got money from CPB for Corporation for Public Broadcasting. And that was a project called World Without Oil. And this was really, really different than what we would normally ever fund. It was called an alternate reality game at the time. And it's kind of different than a lot of alternate reality. Anyone here participated in alternate reality games or an ARG? Anyway, this is basically, was produced by Ken Eklund and Jane McGonigal. And Jane McGonigal went on to write a book called Reality is Broken, which is on the bestseller list, and it's kind of about gaming and game culture and kind of the positive effects that game culture can have. And so this was kind of the first serious social issue ARG, and it's basically a simulation of a worldwide oil crisis. And it kind of takes you through it, and it's, but it's, to me, it's less of an ARG. It doesn't have a lot of game mechanics in it, or traditional game mechanics. It's more of a participatory storytelling project. But I'll show you the trailer real quick, and you'll get an idea of what it's about. And the quality's not great. It's on YouTube here, so.
Prices jumped to over $4 a gallon.
Oh my God, $4 a gallon.
There is very much police state going on in the streets now.
Hey, way or the other, we're all in this together.
This is our local farmer's market.
This is the jinx.
It's peak profit.
Cow here.
So that was, you know, we consider that like a real success. And I guess that that was transmedia in that a lot of the content that was created was, you know, there was video, but people also created blogs, their own personal blogs, and wrote about it. And it was very much about the participants extending the story. So there wasn't a lot of story other than these triggers of like, gas hits $4 a gallon, gas hits $6 a gallon. And it kind of takes you through that over a month. So it was kind of in a month period of time. And then people actually kind of fictionalized what it would be. And of course, some people kind of had the dystopian vision of, oh my God, there's rioting in the streets. But then there were some people that were talking about, you know, their farmer's market and just riding bikes and just some kind of more realistic, probably, ideas. But so that is... So that's sort of one element, I think, of transmedia is just that idea of participatory storytelling and actually opening up the narrative to allow the audience to kind of play a part in extending the story. So another project that we did, and this is actually kind of more similar to what we normally do, which is I oversee an internal initiative where our documentary filmmakers can apply for additional money to do an interactive extension of their film. And so they kind of come up with the idea, and we, based on, you know, if we like their proposals, we will give them some additional funding to create this. And so this is actually very similar to what kind of the model that Michella was talking about with her game, was there was a documentary film called Garbage Dreams, which I highly recommend if you haven't seen it to see. It's an amazing documentary set in Egypt, and it's about a community within Egypt of kind of an underclass that are recyclers, and they do the majority of recycling, and it's just been their way of living for centuries. And now these big kind of commercial recycling companies, multinational companies, are coming in and kind of destroying their way of life. Anyway, great documentary told through the lives of three kids. And so the producer had this idea to create kind of just a flash casual game around recycling that would teach, like an educational game to teach recycling. I think what's interesting about where games and films are kind of complementary is that a film can really create an emotional response. That's what films do well. What games do well is they can teach a system. And when you're talking about, or they can explain a system through kind of the interactions or the immersive play. And I think that those are really nice complements to one another, especially if you're talking about kind of these kind of social issue documentaries, because you can, you know, you can obviously kind of get the emotion across of injustice, but if you want to sort of explain injustice from another perspective, you can actually take them through the system, and a game can do that really well. I'm not going to actually kind of go in, well, maybe I would, because we talked about the goat. I should probably show the goat, huh? There's a goat in this game. It's a very, very simple game, and it's actually based on the U.S. recycling system. So we distributed this in schools. No, we don't want to learn how to play. We just want to recycle. We want to sort some garbage. No. Continue. Okay, oops, I need to upgrade. Sorry. I'm just going to get that. I just want a goat. I just want the goat. Come on. Anyway, so you're under a timer, and you have this big pile of garbage that you have to sort. And like I said, it's kind of the U.S. system of recycling. So So there's the goat, and he eats organic stuff, but you know, you have a little magnifying glass and you can learn about where to recycle this. So this is like a dirty cardboard, and if I try to put it in the paper bin, it's not going to let me do it. But this little apple, the goat will eat. Anyway, you earn points, you earn money, and then you can expand your recycling business as you go. It's a very simple game, but it's been really, really popular for us. And like I said, it's sort of another way of kind of getting at the issue. Do you want me to stop, or do I have?
No, I was going to show. Go ahead, keep going. Yeah.
Are we running out of time?
No. Keep going.
Okay. So the last couple things I wanted to explain or talk about is we have a new project which is really new for us, and this is a project that was born out of a blog, and. You know, normally you would have a film created about something, and then you would kind of create the interactive project second. But this was a film that was actually there are two digital media guys. They're young men based out of New York, Muslim Americans, and they started this project called 30 Mosques, and they did this, they've done it twice now during Ramadan, where during Ramadan they'd basically just go to a mosque in a different state each day. And so they'll hit 30 mosques in 30 days, and they create media around it. They're great photographers, and they create video, and they have little stories about each mosque that they visit. And it's really about discovering sort of the diverse Muslim community within the United States. So the first mosque in the U.S. was in South Dakota. And it was a Syrian community in the like 20s or something. So fascinating stuff that you wouldn't know, generally know. Oh, it's the goat. It's come back. This kind of gets at the idea. There's another concept within transmedia, which is this idea of intertextuality or multimodality, which I know I'm getting academic here, but and that really comes from comic books, which is fascinating. There's a big influence, obviously, in Hollywood around comic books, but the idea of intertextuality is that within comic books, you might have characters show up in one comic book, but they'll also show up in another story, in another comic book somewhere else. And I think that this project has a little bit of that, because what it is, it's about these two bloggers, and they're characters in the story, so they blog about themselves, and it's a personal story. But now there's a documentary filmmaker who kind of came on and said, hey, I want to make a film about these guys. And so we are funding the blog, but we're also funding the documentary film that's going to be made about them. And then they are also kind of working jointly on a coffee table book around their photos. So once again, you know, transmedia is not just digital media, or it's also kind of analog media or media that happens in the real world. And so anyway, that's kind of a totally new funding model for us, like where we're funding kind of something from the other side rather than just the film first. And then finally, like these guys are also a part of a new project that we started, which is a partnership with Mozilla Foundation to create some web native documentaries. And the idea there is that I don't know, has anyone here seen the Wilderness Downtown Arcade Fire videos? Is it Google Chrome experiments? Good. So the idea is actually bringing, with HTML5 video, which is basically using the browser as kind of a canvas now for video, you can actually bring in content from across the web. So social media content, linked content, links from other web pages, as well as kind of a personalized experience. You know, your zip code, so the web knows kind of who you are and where you're at. How does that change the experience of watching video? And we've started this partnership with Mozilla, and we're going to be bringing six of our filmmakers together to sort of experiment with the idea of kind of what does a web native documentary look like? How do we take a documentary film that's created for the web that brings that can, A, kind of personalize it for you. So if I put in my zip code, how can that experience of watching that documentary be different than everyone else's experience? So you know, an idea there would be if we have, for example, we have a film about sea level rise. And so if I put in, you know, if it knows kind of my Twitter account, for example, it could, while I'm watching the film, I could get data about my friends on Twitter who live on the coast, and maybe it'll give me information about when they're going to be underwater in 50 years or something like that. So that's kind of an idea of where you would have a kind of a personalized experience around watching video. So that we're really excited about that. These guys who are doing the 30 Mosques project, that's an opportunity for them to say, okay, I've got a documentary film, I've got this blog, let's see how we can mash them up in some way. It's, you know, Reese's peanut butter cups. I don't know where I'm going. It's late in the day.
No, I think that was it's a good explanation, and it's an interesting point, and you know, I know we're running short on time, but I wanted to ask, just sort of pose a question there based on what you just said about the Mozilla Foundation and that project. It sounds like a great idea, and I think I'm going to put it to everybody here, for all the great ideas that are out there. Do you feel that there's an audience for it, or is the goal to essentially create an audience for it? You know, I know there are people right. that are participating, but in terms of mass media, where do you guys feel that this sort of fits in, and where does it stand? And I'll probably pose it to all of you and have you all say something about it.
I'll pass it on real quick. One of my coworkers said, if you have a chance, in terms of kind of this idea of web native documentary, if you go to the National Film Board of Canada, NFB, if you go to their website, they've got some amazing projects. It's nfb.ca/interactive, I believe. Anyway, I was talking to a colleague at work, and she's like, no one watches that crap. Like, who's watching that crap? And she's like, it's awesome. Like, it's beautiful. It's amazing. But, like, really, who's watching it? And it's, you know, it's one of those things, like, you know, back in the early days of cinema, I mean, I feel like we're kind of at an Eisenstein moment with this technology. And it's very, you know, it's on the cutting edge. There's probably not a mass audience for it, but it's certainly going to be the future at some point, you know, and I think it's like just a matter of time. So anyone want to announce the audience perspective?
Oh, I was just going to say, you know, we first started off with the Home Movie Project to, you know, really be about the archive, so having all the material online. And I felt that we couldn't just argue for the archive, because I felt like, who's going to see it? How will people know about it? So we built in this whole component from the get-go of the project that was about having an engagement strategy that's both online and in person. So bringing those all together to then generate an audience before the archive even launches. And potential ways people can interact, like tell them how people can interact. And then, of course, partnering with folks that could use it as well, like institutions, schools, et cetera.
So I do a little less kind of traditional transmedia work, so I can't really speak to that. But I do know that we did some testing around the global news site around the interest of young people, both in watching global news and also in taking action, learning more about the issues covered in the news. And I think that actually young people are more exposed than ever to global news, and actually more interested than ever. You know, they have Yahoo is their homepage because their mum set up their email account or something like that. So they're seeing and exposed to global news every day. And the top feature, we listed all these features like commenting, liking, using social networks, blah, blah, blah. The absolute top was to learn more about the issue covered in the news. Absolutely. It got like 98% of respondents either somewhat agreed or strongly agreed that was the feature that they wanted. So that kind of gives me hope about the future of this kind of media. And then for View Change, we had a different target audience. You know, we were trying to reach influencers in Capitol Hill, people, journalists who are covering global development, and to be more of a tool and a resource for them. But I have hope.
Well, I'd say the interesting thing is, especially with the work you're doing, Hannah, is thinking about the fact that by sort of democratizing the production of media, you automatically have people that now, in being producers, want to sort of watch what what other people are producing. And so you have a little bit, in some ways, and I think what you're saying, right, Matthew, is that, like, who can watch all of it? And if you are a person that's making, you know, short documentaries about, you know, garbage collectors, and there's like eight other people that are probably doing that. So there is a little bit of, like, there's a lot going on, and trying to cut through it is the, I think, the greatest work, is, like, try to cut through all the other work to find the audience. But I think that's what is exciting about this, is that you don't, unlike traditional media where they decide who they want to sell things to and then who, then they make things based on that, is that you can have an audience, you can have one piece of content, one piece of media, one film can have a very specific audience. And hopefully you can reach many other audiences. But the exciting thing is that you can, instead of having to, you know, devote an entire arm of your organization to deciding you want to try to reach out to girls 12 to 14 and see if it's successful, you can make two films and you can make one game and then try that out and see how it works. And I think that, you know, obviously you still have to see whether, what the best way to get to those young girls are, and don't share it with pedophiles. But there's things that are, that you need to sort of experiment with in having the smaller audiences and being okay with getting smaller audiences because you're getting the right audience.
The difference between me and then the rest of the panel is that I'm doing an individual project and I don't have an organization, so I can't really speak to that as far as an audience goes. But my project is definitely, in a way, driven by audience. So I listen to them, they have ideas, and it's already, it has a built-in engagement to it. So I think that is also a really good way to go with sort of niche or specific stories or projects, is to really know who your audience is and talk to them.
I think that's sort of a good point to probably close on there. I didn't know if we skipped over anybody in the audience that had a question, but if anybody does, please go ahead and stand up and say. Does anybody here want to make any final comments or anything? I think that from what Alpha's saying, that we're not going to be able to show the film. Yeah, it sounds like we're...
We talk too much.
Okay. We'd like Matthew just sort of end with talking about the film that we were going to show, and the program Future States, which I encourage you guys all to look at and see when you get a chance.
Yeah, if you have a chance, since we're not going to be able to show it, if you go to futurestates.tv, this is a web series that ITVS launched 2 years ago, and it's around, we got independent filmmakers to imagine America in the not-so-distant future. So it's very different than what we normally do, which is mostly documentary film, and so this is a way for us to support fiction filmmakers. In fact, one of our filmmakers was just here, and then he left.
He's on the board of the festival, right?
Oh, Tanush. Yeah, that's great. Tanush. So he's one of our filmmakers. So they're 15-minute long films. They're sci-fi, speculative fiction. The one that we were going to show is called Digital Antiquities, which is kind of a great take on sometime in the future when people are kind of going back through trying to basically find secrets and stories from antiquated technology through kind of like a kind of like an antique shop that now has all of these like kind of old gadgets which are current. Anyway, I encourage you to check it out. It's a lot of fun, and I look forward to talking to anyone after the panel.
Well, thank you all. Definitely appreciate it, and I hope you guys all enjoyed it.